So this topic's not very difficult. It's easy for you to understand. The topic's on internal aids to construction. So when we talk about internal aids to construction, what are we referring to? We are referring to the statutes themselves. I mean, so if we are to interpret any particular provision of a statute, internal aids will be whatever you find within the statute. Okay, so the different parts of the statute, and they have different degrees of importance in the interpretation of the statute, the provisions of the statute. Now, because they are from within the statute, ex vis caribus actus, from the four corners of the statute, although I should add a word of caveat here, not everything is to be considered that way. So, if you're referring to what's within the statute, then you're referring to what are known as internal aids to construction. Now, before we go into specifics, the broad rule remains that we are to go with the first rule, okay, the literal rule of interpretation. Okay, we are to adhere to the general plain meaning and all that we discussed in great detail. Now, the thing is, then when do we need internal aids? Obviously, in interpretation, while doing interpretation, we are also subject to, we are to find the true intent of the legislature from using the other canons of interpretation that we discussed. Even if those were not sufficient, okay, what if even those were not sufficient? Then what else can we look at? What else can we take help from in finding the true intent, true meaning of the legislation, provisions of the legislation? So next would be the different internal aids to the interpretation or aids to construction of a statute. So statute has many different parts. So today we are going to start discussing some of these parts which can be of help in interpreting statute. Now you know that every statute has a name. Okay, so let's start with the title of the statute. Okay, so statutes do have two different titles. Okay, one is the short title and the other one is a long title. So short title, usually you find it in the like okay, so you usually find the short title in section one of generally okay in section one of the enactment, because that's how you refer to the act. So usually it's in the form of "this act may be called as so and so." And that's what the short title is. So I have before me one example. You can bring out any such examples, okay? So I have before me the National Food Security Act 2013. So that's the short title. This is pretty easy, nothing to be explained. So usually you find the name of the short title in section one, okay? It could be elsewhere as well, but that's where you find it usually. Now the question is, what's the relevance of short title in construing provisions of an enactment? Nothing really. So it's not of much help, okay? It's not of much help. It's just the name of the act. However, there is also long title, okay? Long title is something that is set out at the head of the statute, okay? And it gives you a fairly, detailed description, complete description of the purpose, of the general purpose and object with which the act has been created. Okay, so it gives you the purpose and objective behind creation of a particular act. Okay, it might also refer to mischief a particular piece of legislation is trying to, address. It may also allude to the nature of the enactment, because that is also necessary in finding out the true purpose and object, and hence the methodology, the rule principle that you're going to use to interpret the particular act. So that's the second. So the long title is of help. Okay. So the act that I just mentioned, the National Food Security Act, here the long title goes like this. So you can easily find it, as I told you. An act to provide for food and nutritional security in human life cycle approach by ensuring access to adequate quantity and quality food at affordable prices to people to live a life with dignity and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. So you see that what's the purpose of the act? To provide for food and nutritional security. That's the purpose, clearly written there. Could be of help, could be of assistance, wherever the rules allow for, you know, referring the rules that we discussed earlier, allow for, you know, reference to the objects and purposes. You can find it from here. And how it is to be done, okay, ensuring access to, so that's another object or purpose, you can say, access to adequate quantity of quality food at affordable prices. So this is something which is of much help. So that's very important, okay. So long title is considered as a part of the act, okay. And it can definitely, because it is part of the act, okay, because it is part of the act, it's admissible as an aid to construction. So that's basically the idea. So long title and statutes quite often also have, you know, preambles. So long title and preambles together can provide the details for, you know, provide the purpose and object with which the law has been enacted. So the general rule, you know, behind purposes, okay, behind purposive construction is like when the words are not clear enough. If the words are clear enough, if you look at the enacting, you know, portions of the act, okay, the provisions that create rights, obligations, whatever, the enacting provisions of the act, okay, if they're clear on their own, then there is no reason to limit or expand the meaning of those provisions by referring to objects and purposes. There's no necessity for that. However, it's not always the case that they are clear. So in such case, we have read in many different places, okay, I'm not going to go into details, that to find out the true meaning of the word, okay, you then may refer to the objects and purposes. So this is where you may find the objects and purposes and could be of help in interpreting a particular provision of a statute. So this is what the rule is with respect to, with respect to your long title. So we have certain cases, okay, so I'll take one case where it has been, you know, referred to explicitly. The case goes by the name Ashwini Kumar Ghosh versus Aravinda Bose. Just a second. So this is the case, okay. In this particular case, the court was dealing with Supreme Court's Advocates Practice in High Courts Act 1951. That's the short title, and the long title was an act to authorize the advocates of the Supreme Court to practice as of right in any high court. Okay. Now, what's the problem here? So Justice Asser Das had made the following observation that one cannot be but impressed at once with the wording of the full title of the act. So it's referring to the long title of the act. Although there are observations in the earlier English cases that the title is not part of the statute and is therefore to be excluded from consideration in construing statutes, it is now settled law that the title of the statute of a statute is an important part of the act and may be referred to for the purposes of ascertaining its general scope and throwing light on its construction, and although it cannot override the clear meaning of the enactment. Basically what I was trying to explain to you, okay, that's what was being referred to. So further said that the long title cannot control the express operative provisions of the acts. Now you know that Long title is not the operative provision, okay, clearly know that. So it cannot control the express operative provisions, okay. If the meaning is clear, then the long title cannot override it, because it's quite probable, quite possible that, you know, even though there are certain general objects and purposes with which the enactment has been made, okay, however, in certain specific provisions, they might provide exceptions, okay, certain cases where they are not following the objectives. So why would the judges then, you know, negate that, okay? So that's not what is allowed, okay? Only when there, you know, confusions arise, okay, where, you know, looking at it, looking at the long title can throw some light, you know, on the specific issue and help in construction. Only in those matters will the long title be, can the long title be referred to for the sake of understanding the true meaning of the particular provision. Similarly, we have an English case where the same rule has also been referred to in today's times, okay? So in this particular case goes by the name Ward versus Holman. In this particular case, we're concerned with section 3 of an 1861 act, okay, that abrogated the common law rule that a change of domicile operated as a revocation of testamentary disposition. Anyway, we are concerned about what has been said. So, and the long title of the act is an act to amend the law with respect to wills of personal estate made by British subjects. So you see, it's quite, you know, general, okay? So the general provision of the act here will not be limited in the light of this particular long title. So it was held that the section was of general, you know, application. So the long title may become a very relevant, if in any case there is some genuine ambiguity or lack of clearness in the application of the act to particular facts. But where the wording is clear and unambiguous, its meaning cannot be restricted. So that's the rule, as has been, you know, held. And just like this, okay, just like the long title is quite often followed by preamble. Not every legislation has a preamble, but many do. So when there is a preamble, then preamble can also throw light on the purpose, objective of, you know, behind the enactment of a particular statute. So it may refer to the scope, object, purpose, the mischief that it's trying to, you know, address. All those things can be found. So the preamble along with the long title could be of help. So it's here that the main objects of the act are laid down, okay, and are therefore legitimate aids in construing the enacting parts of the act, okay? So they are legitimate parts, like aids in construing the enacting parts, okay? They are not the enacting parts. So just like, you know, as in the case of you know, preamble to the constitution, it's not enacting parts of the constitution, but is considered as the part of the constitution, especially after your Keshavananda Bharti's case. So, and quite often that can be taken to, for example, in the case of, you know, constitution, the basic structure doctrine can be, you know, justified by referring to the preamble of the constitution. Likewise, here as well, I mean, see, it's not exactly where you get the, you know, the rights, duties, you know, obligations, you know, from, but they can definitely clarify the intent with which an act has been enacted. So it's of great, you know, good weight, okay, although not of the same weight as that of the enacting provision, but they are of aid. They can be a legitimate aid in construction, as has been held in the famous Sussex Peeress case. 1844, I'll just type the name here. So yes, this is not an enacting part only expresses scope, object and purpose of the act, which can be referred to clarify the true meaning of enacting provision of a statute. So that's there. So it may recite the ground, the cause for making the statute, the mischief, the evils that are to be remedied. So the doubts may then be, you know, settled in the light of all this, you know, that can be found. So you can take up many such examples. You will usually find that after the long title, it explains what the enactment is for. Usually it starts with whereas. Okay, so whereas in order to one enactment, one example I have is the West Bengal Cooperative Societies Act 2006. It referred to whereas in order to infuse new life into the cooperative movement of West Bengal on the face of the new challenge of globalization and liberalization. So you see, it's giving in great detail the reason, the purpose with which, you know, it has been enacted. So if you just click on this, you will find it. So from there you can clearly identify what the object and purpose of an enactment is. So that's an important aid. It's part of the statute, not an enacting part, but it's very much part of the statute. Now, one very important case with regard to this, okay, as to what is the importance of preamble in the interpretation of a statute has been decided in the famous case by the name Attorney General versus HRS Prince Ernest Augustus of Hanover, 1957. This is a case in which it has been laid down to great detail as to how, what is the importance of preamble. So Lord Normand had said in this particular case, and I quote, that it is clearly permissible to have recourse to the preamble as an aid to construing the enacting provisions. The preamble is not, however, of the same weight as an aid to construction of a section of the act, as are other relevant enacting words to be found elsewhere in the act or even in related acts. Now that's something we know already. There is a sequence of importance. So that way it comes later, but it's nonetheless important. So it says, there may be no exact correspondence between preamble and enactment, and the enactment may go beyond or it may fall short of indications that may be gathered from the preamble. Again, the preamble cannot be of much or any assistance in construing provisions which embody qualifications or exceptions from the operation of the general purpose of the act. Again, I explained this earlier that, yeah, quite often the enactments create qualifications, exceptions. Then you wouldn't limit. You wouldn't say that, well, those limits and, you know, exceptions are not justified because it's not in accordance with the general purposes. No, it's not to be assumed either. It is only when it conveys a clear and definite meaning in comparison with relatively obscure or indefinite enacting words that the preamble may then legitimately prevail. Okay, so that prevail as in it just, you know, clarifies the meaning. So that's what is being said. So we can take one more case, and that will suffice for this topic. So the next important case goes by the name G. Soaria. Second. The case goes by the name G. Soaria Raj versus Bandaru Pawani 2009 regarding Hindu Marriage Act Section 5. Okay. So in this particular case, we are concerned with Section 5 of Hindu Marriage Act. Okay, talks about the conditions for Hindu marriage. It goes like this: a marriage may be solemnized between any two Hindus if so and so. The question is whether the may here, may be solemnized, is to be treated as mandatory. So does that mean, okay, that both parties must be Hindus as defined in Section 2 of the Act? So to find that, they have to refer to the preamble. Okay, or basically they have to refer to the long title, which says an act to amend or codify the law relating to marriage among Hindus. From this, they came to the conclusion that, well, it has to be marriage between two Hindus. It cannot be one Hindu and one from some other religion. So yeah, so both long title and preamble may be referred to in interpreting provisions of a statute, but not when they are very clear. So if they are very clear, then the preamble or long title will not negate the enacting provisions of a particular statute. So yeah, that's there. And then the next important internal aid is headings. Headings are very important, okay? They are like the preamble to a particular group of sections. So they are very important in the interpretation of statute. You know that they cannot control the plain words, obviously. They are not enacting provisions. Enacting provisions are the provisions themselves. So, however, they are important. So they are, where do you find headings? So, as I told you find them prefixed to a group of sections and can be referred to in construing an act of a particular legislature. But what is the weight that we are to add to headings? That is a question that has divided many. Some say that it is to be treated with importance, as is the case with the others. And others say that, well, it is not of much weight. So one view says that, it is to be regarded as, giving the key to interpretation of clauses. Okay. So just like, preambles or, can be considered as key to, open the, minds of the legislatures. Okay. Same way it has been said that headings could point to the, the broad purpose, for which the law has been, the enacting provisions have been enacted. So could definitely be key to, opening that. But there are others who do not agree, who disagree. So the other view is, says that resort to the heading can only be taken when the enacting words are ambiguous, okay, only in those situations. I think that's the one that prevails. Only when it is difficult, okay, it is ambiguous, can you then refer to the headings. Because within those group of sections, there could be one that does not reflect the general, heading, okay, whatever you find in the heading. So in such case, that will not be negated by the heading. But if ambiguities remain, then it can definitely be referred to. So Justice Patanjali Sastri had said that, nor can the title of a chapter be legitimately used to restrict the plain terms of an enactment. So if the terms of the enactment are plain, clear, then plain words cannot be restricted by the headings. So that's basically the rule. Now, do we have cases? There are many such other examples that you can refer to. But we'll take one or two, one case, and that will explain what it is all about. So we have a case by the name N.C. Dhondial versus Union of India, 2004. In this particular case, we are concerned with Section 36(2) of Protection of Human Rights Act. Okay, and 1994. So, and it deals with matters not subject to jurisdiction of commission. So it says matters not subject to jurisdiction of commission. That's the heading of the group of sections. And what does the specific section say? Section 36 clause 2 says the commission or state commission shall not inquire into any matter after expiry of 1 year from the date on which the act constituting violating human rights is alleged to have been committed. The question is whether it is procedural matter or a jurisdictional, jurisdictional matter. Okay. So heading, as I read out to you, it clearly says matters not subject to the jurisdiction of the commission. So it deals with the jurisdiction. So the previous, the section cannot be dealt as merely procedural. Okay. That's what had been held. So it said in that particular judgment that the language employed in the marginal heading is another indicator that it is a jurisdictional limitation. It is a settled rule of interpretation that section heading and marginal note can be relied upon to clear any doubt or ambiguity. So that's the only situation when it can be used in the interpretation of the provision and to discern the legislative intent. So, yeah, so that's the importance of, headings. They are like the preamble to a group of sections, but then they can be used to remove ambiguity, but they will not control the plain words. The next important internal aid, or maybe they are not, but they have been used sometimes, is the marginal notes. Now, what are marginal notes? If you just click on the link that I had shared a little while ago, the act by the name West Bengal Cooperative Societies Act 2006, as you can see, marginal notes are clearly there to your left hand side. For example, next to section 1, you can see it says short title, extent and commencement. State, then in section 2, it says state policy on cooperative societies. So clearly, as you can see, they are on the margins. And this is not something that is debated on. This is not something that is, argued in the parliament or legislature. So what's the importance of this? So what are marginal notes? In Nicholson versus Fields, it has been said that notes found printed at the side of the sections in an act, which purport to summarize the effect of the sections and have sometimes been used as aid to construction. So sometimes they have been used as an aid. But then what is the importance? Remember that when marginal notes are attached to the constitution itself, okay, those marginal notes have greater weight than the marginal notes that you find in any other ordinary legislation. So much more discussion happens with respect to the constitution than in case of other ordinary statutes. So much less, the marginal notes are usually added by people who are not legislatively responsible, okay? So they are just inserted by people who are not responsible, okay? So they do not form the part of that legislative process. For the ease of reference to particular group of sections, particular section that you refer to it there, okay? So they are not part of the statute, unlike your long title, preamble, etc. They are not part of the statute, and therefore the view is that they should not be considered because they are not part of the statute. So they are not inserted by the parliament nor under the authority of the parliament but by other people who are not responsible in the same way. So that's the view. So Justice Patanjali Shastri had said, marginal notes in an Indian statute, as in an act of parliament, cannot be referred to for the purpose of construing statute. However, is that the only view though? With time, the view changes a little bit. Sometimes maybe they can be, okay? So, there's another view that says that sometimes they may be referred to. So in one particular case, just a second, let me find out the name of the case. It's not Indian case, so you can refer to Justice Patanjali's views for the Indian case, but there's another view that says that, as was held in R versus Montilla, just a second, I'll type the name. So in this particular case, it was said that it was held that the question then is, it was held that they cannot be, so marginal notes, okay, cannot be completely ignored. So it's the view of the House of Lords that they cannot be completely ignored. Why is that? The side notes now appear as headings, okay, and although headings and side notes are not debated in Parliament, and are therefore unamendable, they are unamendable obviously because they are not enacting provisions. So however, because they appeared there and they also appeared through the debate as well, although they are not debated but they might appear through the debate, so they cannot be completely ignored. Okay, so they further said the question then is whether headings, we have discussed headings already, and side notes, although unamendable, can be considered in construing a provision in an act of parliament. It says account must of course be taken of the fact that these components were included in the bill, not for debate but for ease of reference, just so that you find a particular, you know, branch of section easily. So this indicates that less weight can be attached to them than to the parts of the act that are open for consideration and debate in parliament, but it is another matter to be required by rule of law to disregard them altogether. So that's what we cannot do. We cannot completely disregard them. One cannot ignore the fact that headings and side notes are included on the face of the bill throughout its passage through the legislature, although not inserted by a responsible person. They are there for guidance. They provide the context for an examination of those parts of the bill that are open for debate, subject of course to the fact that they are unamendable. They ought to be open to consideration as part of the enactment when it reaches the statute book. So if it manages to reach the statute book, maybe we should refer to them, is the view. So even in India, the idea now should be that it should be in restricted situation, in much, you know, more restricted situation, therefore may be referred to. But when it comes to constitution, the marginal notes are of much greater importance than in the case of ordinary statute. Okay guys, I think I'll have to stop it for today. I'm getting calls from examination.